Hi, I'm Mathew Jonson, and I'm here with Electronic Beats TV. I'm going to be giving you guys a demonstration today with the SH-101 synthesizer from Roland. This is a synthesizer that came out in 1983 and was probably the most popular out of the SH line at the time. It's a very simple synthesizer. It was actually made to be simple. It was made so that kind of ease of use, everything very ergonomic, and there's not too many synthesizers like this that really feel like an instrument that you can really play. And so I've been using it since the mid-90s, and it's what I bring on the road. It's what I play with a band I'm in called Cobblestone Jazz, where it's fully improvisation, and it really is, it's the best synthesizer I can think of as far as having on stage to improvise with. So I'm going to give you a brief introduction as far as how the synthesizer works. I'm going to start by just giving you a pulse wave here, and you can hear the LFO modulating the frequency of the filter. This can also modulate the VCO. Right now we're on a triangle wave. You can have a square wave, random waves, or noise. Good for making wind sounds. So, in the oscillator section, there's just one oscillator, but it gives you different waveforms. You have pulse width, you have saw, and you have a sub-oscillator. And so we have our saw here, and we have our sub-oscillator, which can also go down two octaves or turn into a pulse. The SH-101 has a really nice filter. I think it's 22 dB per octave, maybe. And this can be modulated by the envelope. And also the LFO. And it has a keyboard width, which allows you to play octaves when you resonate the filter itself. So this can be used to make some nice harmonics. Because you only have one oscillator and you don't have tuning really per se with any other method here, you can use the self-oscillation of the filter in conjunction with the waveforms from the oscillator to create overtones. Simple envelope, attack, decay, sustain, release. I really like this because it's sliders, and so it allows me to kind of adjust the envelope in real time very easily. I'll give you a better example when I get to sequencing here as far as the way that I play this, but it really allows you to kind of develop sequences and just really make it kind of more musical. I find using knobs for this can be a little bit more difficult. And so to have it like this, have everything kind of laid out where you can play and get your hands involved, I think the layout is really fantastic. So I'm going to get into sequencing a little bit for you guys. The SH-101 sequencer is pretty much as basic as it gets, but I like this. I like the simplicity of it. Because for making music like house and techno and things where you want maybe something quite repetitive, and also it doesn't necessarily need to be super complicated, the sequencer is great. And the way that it works is you just hit load, and then you play in a sequence of notes. You can use the key transpose to adjust where the octave is sitting, and so I'm just going to hit load and put in some notes. Mm-hmm. I've chosen the notes. It doesn't matter what rhythm I played when I put in those notes, because the rhythm is going to come from an external trigger, which is here. And so I've got the circlon set up, which is going to send triggers over to the internal sequencer of the 101. And so when I hit play, if I've got, let's say any, like I put in 16 notes here. So if I put in 16 notes here, it's gonna revolve in a loop. Okay, so I can just put in 16 triggers there quickly. And you can hear that looping properly. Now, when it comes to actually playing this, there's different ways of making, kind of keeping it interesting, I guess you could say, because you don't want to necessarily just have the same loop going the whole time. And so obviously you've got all these parameters here that you can use in order to do that. Now, one thing I like to do is I like to time up the LFO so that it will start modulating these notes. I've kind of got it on about a quarter note speed. Tricky. It's really touchy. It's like mixing records. You know, you have to really kind of be very specific as far as where you want that slider to be in order to time it up. Sometimes I'll be having a hard time timing it up, so I'll actually adjust the master tempo of the sequencer to get it to be where I want it to be. And I actually don't like it to really be perfect. I kind of like it to be slowly sliding off, because that kind of it kind of makes it evolve. And when you're using a triangle wave for the LFO, in that sequence, when it's coming up and down, you're hitting different notes and you're accentuating different notes as that LFO cycles through the sequence. So let's say over, you know, 32 bars, you may have a point where each of the peak of the LFO is accentuating different notes. So this is one way I'll get a little bit of movement. Now you have the pitch of the VCO. This can also be changed. You've got your mixer as far as the different waveforms you have. You have a noise oscillator if you want to bring that in. And then you've got your filter. Envelope. Now, in terms of the way I would perform this, let's say I'm playing with a band and I want to kind of introduce the synthesizer line. So I might have this line written, but I might have the envelope all the way down. And you can hear a little bit of kind of ticking in the background, but I don't mind this actually, because it's in rhythm anyways, and it comes across as being quite percussive. So it doesn't really bother me. So now, in terms of how I might play this, and I might actually put some drums in the background just to kind of give you a better idea. Okay, so we've got the 808 playing some drums for us. Now, I might introduce this and only play a certain amount of notes. And the way that I'm going to do that is by using the decay of the envelope. If I open that up, it's going to play a note. So I might just introduce a few notes at a time and then kind of make it evolve into something more musical as I go on. One thing I'll do is I'll kind of leave space, you know, because if I'm playing with other musicians, they can kind of fill in the gaps, and then I can kind of use this to kind of have a conversation back and forth with whoever I'm playing with. It's kind of like in a jazz idea of playing rather than classical music, I suppose. Now, aside from using the decay, I can also use the attack. And this will kind of reverse notes into each other. Now, that's one way of kind of making it musical, making it evolve. Then you can do things like kind of where you may want to have like a little bit kind of more like effects and changes. You can do things by modulating the VCO, and because the LFO is running at a quarter note speed, if I bring up the modulation on the VCO, it'll kind of always be in that same place. You also have portamento control on the notes, and legato, which also is really nice to be able to use. So if I can give you another sequence here, I'll kind of demonstrate how the legato works. I'm just gonna leave it in with 16th note triggers, keep it simple for you guys. So if I'm gonna put in some notes here now, I might put in 1, 2, I'm gonna hold that down, legato, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now if I turn the portamento up when it's in auto mode, it's going to bend up to that note that I selected legato on. So you can kind of get these kind of acid lines, kind of 303 style. You can also just have it on regular portamento by turning the portamento on to on, and then that will also switch. So I might play with that also while I'm jamming or recording a synthesizer line. You don't always have to have 16th note triggers, of course. If you have a line in your head that you want to play that's kind of more musical and not so modular sounding, you can also put in a certain amount of triggers to match that sequence. And this is something like with cobblestone jazz I would do a lot, because obviously, you know, I'm listening to a keyboard player play. I'm kind of going along, I'm playing some drums, and I've got to come up with a bass line. You know, we don't have a bass line unless I write a bass line. So I might come in here and put in something like this. And we know know that's 1, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. So that we know that's nine notes, which means there has to be nine triggers now coming from the circlon in order to make that work, right? So I can either come here and I can tap in nine triggers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Or if I want, I could hit record and tap them in on the keyboard. I wanted to do another bass line. You know, it's really simple. Let's say. Now, right now, that bass line has a different amount of triggers as this one. You know, and that's why it's not looping properly. Okay, so I'm gonna take these triggers off. And it's tricky sometimes, you know, like you have to play around with it a little bit. Sometimes you'll load something in, you'll think you had the right amount of triggers. You didn't, so easy, just do it again. And I'll give you guys another bass line. You can have an idea as far as how this works. Maybe I'll put in eighth note triggers for that. Maybe something a little bit more complicated, maybe. Up so you can hear it better. I'll do it again. So I'll give you guys another bass line, give you an idea of doing separated triggers. You get an idea of how the sequencer works. And so it's really fast. You know, if I wanna have that bass line going, let's say I have two 101s on stage, you know, or let's say I've got, you know, this one, this guy, and then this guy, which is what I usually bounce a lot with on stage. You know, I'll kind of write a line on this one and then write a line on this one. And I just do that in the headphones. And one thing you can do with this one, which is nice, you can also save sequences with this. So if you wanted to have a bunch of pre-programmed sequences, you know, that you made in the studio before, you can bring it to the show. This one also has some other nice features to it as well. It's got polyphony. It has velocity sensitivity if you want it on the sequencer. It's also got chord memory. So, you know, so there's some nice new features on this one that you can't do with this. It's a little bit small, of course, you know, but in terms of making, you know, really kind of musical movements. But I've played just with this one, and it works. It's great, and it really sounds good. So another way we can use the 101, rather than triggering it externally with and using the sequencer here, we can plug it in with CV gate as well. And there's a few things you can do with that CV gate that allow you to do things that you can't do with the internal sequencer, which I'll show you. So now you're just hearing the sequencer playing the 101 now. And so if I was to come here, I can put in a couple notes. And I can just select the notes here. Right, so you've got a sequence now that's being played externally by the Circlon sequencer. Now, one thing you can't do with the internal sequencer is control your gate times. You know, this is just sending a trigger to the envelope. And so your gate times, this is kind of also why I'm playing with the decay a lot when I'm using the internal sequencer, is to kind of give it that variation. If you're using an external sequencer, we can come and we can adjust the lengths of the notes here. And that's gonna give the 101 a very different feel, of course. Now, another thing that allows you to do, if you're controlling the length of the notes externally via CV gate, that also allows you to now use this envelope, if you want, just for the frequency of the envelope. And it doesn't affect the timing of the notes, or the length of the notes, I should say. So I've got this in gate mode now. So the timing, the length of the notes is coming from the external sequencer. And then I can use the envelope to create my frequency modulation. So this opens up a lot of possibilities, because obviously it's a totally different sound when you have the same envelope controlling the filter and as well as the amplitude of the notes, versus now we've got external gate signals coming in order to do that. So I'll do a bit of both. You know, in the studio I do this. I'll also use this internal sequencer, but on stage I'm pretty much just using the internal sequencer just because it's so fast and easy. And I like to kind of use this mostly for improvisation, rather than having pre-programmed lines on it. Now there's another thing you can do as well. This might take me a second to wire up here, but you can also send external gates through the input of the external clock in. A lot of people don't realize that you can do this with the 101. But so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to trigger So now the way that I've got it set up now is that I'm sending my note data from one channel of the CV gate. And then on another track, I'm sending another gate signal into the external clock input. And this is allowing me to control the, to trigger the envelope externally. And that is going to be affecting the frequency. So this gives you control kind of like a TB-303, for example, where you can actually do accents on the filter cutoff. So my triggers are here, right? If I was just to have it on the one of the bar. So now we're only hearing that first note. And you can hear, as I adjust the envelope, you can hear the rest of the sequence still going in the background, trailing off, but it's only opening just on that one, that first trigger. If I open up the decay, you can hear those notes in the background. Now if I was to add some more triggers, this is kind of my little secret, I guess you should say. Because I don't think I know anybody that does this. Right, so now we're opening up the cutoff frequency with these external triggers. And the setting I've got that to do that is, it says it's an LFO. And to be honest, it's not in the manual doing this. I'm not sure even why it works. I actually just learned how to do it by figuring out as much as I could about this machine. And I just kind of came across the fact that I could do that with it. Usually in this mode, it would be the LFO that would be triggering the envelope. But when you have this external trigger plugged in, then somehow it's bypassing that. So that's kind of like a little secret.